I forgot when we were ordering the service of worship to be as seamless as possible that I was going to follow that. Let's see what happens. Let's pray. Prepare our hearts, O Lord, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may obey your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The scripture reading this morning is from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18. Perhaps familiar, it's about putting on the full armor of God. And this becomes a space in our life. We are thinking through the different parts of our heart that is a home into which Christ enters. And now we enter into another room, the room where we spend time. Hear the word of the Lord. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm, then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert. And always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. This is the word of the Lord. There is probably in each of our lives a room in which we spend time. That's what we do there. Spend time. The time we gained by hard work and long hours and sustained effort, we now spend. What we do there, it seems to others, is simply to use up time, and perhaps less charitably, they might think that we waste time there. But to the one expending time, it is some of the best time spent anywhere. It need not be a special or separate space, though occasionally it's a highly specialized place. It may not be in your home, though it most often is in the home. It is the place where, if a member of your family wants to find you, they know to look for you there. This is the place of time. Imagine now that this is a room in your home, a place in your heart where you spend time. Jesus wants and waits to come into this room too. Now, the language and grammar of time is frequent in Paul's letters. He's an apostle of time well spent. We hear and see both in his letters and as we travel with him on missionary journeys in the book of Acts that this man knows how to spend time. And at the end of his days, wasn't it all spent well? And this letter to the church at Ephesus is no exception. Importantly, he speaks of redeeming the time. But we need to be careful here. This does not mean to produce or to consume more, to maximize the time. It may, in fact, be less. Something has changed when Jesus enters the room. To be more clear on what might take place in this room, you might do a wide variety of things there, or it may be a place where you usually can be found doing the same thing and only that one thing each time. Do you read there? Great books, or flip through magazines, translate Latin, read the paper, do the crossword puzzle, solve Sudoku. Do you write letters, send and receive email there, surf the internet? Do you watch television, Netflix, old home movies now on DVD? Do you flip the channels constantly? That should be a competitive sport. Do you check out the scores? That's my phrase. Lois and I don't own a television. We're not bragging or complaining, but it's a common area. A few times I want to watch television, it's usually available, and I'll go down. So I'll say to Lois Sunday afternoon, I went down to check out the scores. She saw me again next on Tuesday. This is a room where you spend time. Do you listen to music there? Make music, compose, practice an instrument. Hum and whistle till your heart's content. Do you close the door because it's important that only you hear your music? Do you tinker with tools? Make stuff, fix stuff, break stuff. Do you knit, crochet, weave, sew? Do you plan ahead there, play around there? All of the above, all at the same time? Or do you just look out the window and watch the world go by? Just sit and think, or best of all, take a nap. Or maybe the opposite of all that, it seems. Your life feeling to you too sedentary? The time you spend there is highly active. You ski and surf, sometimes on the same day. You walk the beaches and the parks. You shop and cook and garden and plan meals and feed others. You throw or catch or hit or shoot or putt or kick a ball. Or again, better still, do you lace up and put a stick to a puck? This is the place where when you are asked, what were you doing in there? You can say with perfect honesty, nothing. It's a place where you spend time. Yet something important happens there. That something cannot be calculated so much on the production and consumption scale. That something is perhaps closest to the human need and activity called recreation, creation. One does not need to feel guilty about having such a space in our lives and spending time there. We do not always need to be doing. We are, let's remind ourselves, human beings, not human doings. I learned that line. It's a great line, but it was used against me when I first heard it. I don't know about you, but in my childhood, on Saturday morning, that was family household chore day. All the kids joined in. So that'd be me and my sister and any of the 22 foster children that were raised in our home, again, not all at the same time, and we would work. And Mom would make the assignments, Dad would make the assignments, and when the assignments were over, hopefully sometime shortly after lunch, we could go and play ball or whatever we wanted to do. I was never convinced of the importance of this time. I'm still not convinced of the importance of this time. But I raised my children to respect the Saturday morning family chores time because my parents made me, so I'm making them. Somewhere in one of those years, my youngest daughter just looked me in the eye and said, Dad, I'm not a human doing. I'm a human being. She's now an attorney. This space is the place where we go to be. Often in a contemporary home, it's a tech room or a rec room. The toys and tools of recreation are increasingly sophisticated, but it's into this space also now Jesus comes. Remember, it's the space where the greatest commodity is time. It's where we spend time. It's where we can be. Now, when Jesus enters this room, he knows what we do not, how much time we have, and what the next time will be. The Psalms plead with God to remind us that our time is limited, and so to be wise, teach us to number our days. The Psalms teach us also that today was given by God, and so we are to enjoy it fully. Enjoy it fully. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. It chants. A wise enjoyment of time. He